great. Thank you so much, and welcome to Aspetar, for those of you for whom it's the first time. And our friends and family who are familiar with Aspetar, welcome to this exciting day where we are part of the World Boxing Championships, as you know, and we're part of the lead-up to the Rio Olympics in 2016. And Aspetar's vision and mission is to be part of the very best in sports medicine and in promoting health for activity for health. And so this is really a typical sort of event that brings out the best of Aspetar. So I've got a job to just introduce four of our VIPs to get going. You'll hear from the president of AIBA, Mr. Wu, President Wu. You'll hear from our DG, Dr. Mohammed. You'll hear from our new CMO, Dr. Scott. And then our head of dentistry, sports dentistry, will we'll open the session formally. But first, it's a great pleasure to introduce President Wu, who's from Taiwan, and he's the president of AIBA, the Boxing Federation, the International Boxing Federation. He was an architect and town planner by training. He boxed for a short time, he says, and he trained at Oxford and then went to Liverpool, and I believe he might be a Liverpool supporter in the Premier League. So, President Wu, please come up, and we're very happy to have you in Aspetar.
Thank you for the introduction. I would just like to repeat it. I'm a sportsman. My fundamental sport was basketball, but I love boxing. When I was in the middle school, I entered the boxing team because I admire the courage and the bravery of the boxer. When you enter the rings, there's nowhere you can hide. You have to face, to win or to lose. So that inspired me in many, many things and give me a lot of the, I would say, hint to the development of my career. Anyway, I think boxing, we have the world championship here in Qatar. This is the first time the world championship moved to Middle East. Having this world championship, we are having the final today, and tomorrow we finish. But anyway, up to now, after 10 days competition, first of all, I want to really express our thanks to the organization here. The Aspetar, I think this is organization helping the AIBA in the organizing this very important event. And because medical has been always a number one concern. Why? Because we are a body contact sport. Body contact sports, also the head protection, facial protection, all of this become a very, very important of the sports of boxing. Boxer used to wear the head guard, protect the head. But before 1984, there was no head guard. But the 1984 Olympic Games in United States, then introducing the head guard. Since then, almost 30 years, we're wearing the head guard in the competition. The problem comes, wearing the head guard, the concussion continue happen. And then we have decided this is a very important part of our scientific research, medical research, to see why wearing the head guard still causing so much head injury, the concussion. And we study more than 10,000, 11,000 actually the figure, from the 11,000 bout, and based on all the data collected, and our medical commission, and our scientific research commission, and we have this intensive research based on this data. And it proved probably the wearing the head guard, the transmission of the heat to the head guard, then vibrate into the brain, and that causing the concussion. So I made the decision 2 years ago. So remove the head guard for our boxer and see how it affected. And after these 2 years, concussion is almost dropped to zero now. For these world championships, we're coming to a final today. In the last 8 days of competition, concussion is zero up to now. No single concussion. No concussion, certainly, this is a very prime concern of the boxer. No damage to the brain. However, 2 years ago, when we removed, we found the cutting increase. Why? Because when the boxer wear the head guard, they feel they are protected. Then using the head, hit each other. And then when they removed head guard, they still using the same tactic. Tactics using the head still hit each other, then immediately causing the cut. And this is because they get used to that. We found this. Then how to reduce the cut become a very, very important task. Then after we look into the issue, not only because of the boxers' tactics, the habit causing this cut, but also I think the elbow also during the competition to hit the other boxer. So how to reduce this? Then we create a move now, a movement I think is called the heads up. The boxer must maintain the heads up, because when you have the heads up, keep your upright position to box, there will be a clear boxing. So you can see in this championship, the boxing competition is now very clear. The head is no more down, his head is up now. And yesterday, I received the medical report every day. But yesterday report proved cut is also zero now. So no more cut. I also give you a figure. 2013, when the world championship was held in Almaty, in Kazakhstan, that was the first time removed head guard. The boxer, after removed, they using the head each other. We tried to stop this, but however, the end of the world championships, the cut was figure was 43 in the last world championships. And up to today, in these world championships, after all these changes on these tactics of the boxer, keep the head up, and up to now, only 5. So from 43, drop to 5. And we need to continue, but we're still not happy. We still have some cut. The reason is the development of the glove, the technology, the material inside the glove, the padding is very, very well designed. And the padding can absorb a lot of this heat or the punch to the boxer. And because that is exists now, using the glove to punch your head for the skin never create a cut. The cut only by the hard stuff. The only thing during the competition, the hard one is the head and the elbow. So now we have this heads up, the cut is reduced, and the boxers are protected. But we talk about today's subject is the orofacial trauma. Trauma, I think we certainly look into this by our medical commission and protect the teeth, the mouthpiece we develop. And now the damaging the injury from the teeth is also reduced almost very, very, very few. And so overall, our protection of the athletes, the boxers' health and the safety, we now gradually achieve. International Olympic Committee also very concerned, but I think they respect International Federation. You do your research, you do your study, and you tell us your removed head guard is proof to be safe. So we based on that, we give the data. Now the IOC medical department, medical commission, working closely with our medical commission. Our chairman of commission, Dr. Kadrick, is here. And with this joint effort to work and try to find the really the best solution, I think IOC feel, yes, we are right on the right track. All the scientific research, the data proof the boxing is removed, the head guard is safe. So we really feel in the international sports movement, every athlete need to be having this precaution. Precaution is try to preventing this kind of injury happen to the athletes. AIBA, we are very responsible for this. So we concern and we work and now we prove. So this will be something happen ahead of us. It is officially, you will probably see the next Olympic Games in Rio 2016. And after more than 30 years, nearly 40 years now, remove the head guard. The face of the boxer can be seen. And the boxer also very, very happy because when they wear the head guard, the visibility is narrow. And also, I think the head guard itself during the competition, because they put the head guard, probably the previous boxer also wear that one. And also the very, from the hygiene point of view, is not very good. And so all these factors added. So I'm very responsibly to tell you, AIBA working on this very, very heartily. And we want to prove the change of our competition without the head guard, it is safe for the boxer. Once again, I want to take this opportunity to thank the Aspetar to organize this very, very important symposium. This help not only for boxing sport, but I think other sports will also be benefit from this symposium. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to speak with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, President Wu. And I'll now call on the Director General of Aspetar, Dr. Mohammed Gaith Al-Khwari, to come up to the microphone, please.
Assalamu alaikum and good morning. President of AIBA and our distinguished speaker and guest, on behalf of Aspetar, I would like to welcome you in our official symposium that we hosted parallel of the World Championship. Over the past 8 years, Aspetar committed to cover several international championship from medical part. And in 2014, we start to contribute in medical education, a part of these championships, because it's opportunity to strengthen our mission, to upgrade the skills of health professionals who are taking care of athletes during the competitions. This symposium came a part of this strategy in Aspetar, a part of our coverage for this important event. We are focusing on very important subject for any medical team taking care of boxer health. I would like to thank all who are involved in this organization of this symposium. I would like even to thank the President of AIBA and his team for their support, because without their support, we cannot have this event as a part of our coverage for the championship. Also for Qatar Boxing Federation, for their continuous support and working with this organizing committee for this symposium. And by end of this symposium, we have to take all the messages from our speaker that they are going to exchange their experience in their field. All the best for all who are participating in this symposium, and thank you very much.
Shukran jazilan. And one of the things those of us at Aspetar take for granted is that the multinational and international nature of Aspetar. And there are over 60 countries represented in the staff at Aspetar, and we just expect that in our day-to-day life. But so when people come, they're often struck by the diversity and the ability of Aspetar to pull together the best from all parts of the world. And on that note, our previous chief medical officer was from the former Yugoslavia and then worked in Belgium, Professor Nevo Popovic. And now we have the pleasure of having an international American chief medical officer, Dr. Scott Gologli from Atlanta, and he worked with the Atlanta Thrashers and the Atlanta Falcons, the professional football and hockey teams, and so he has a lot of experience with concussion, and he actually chaired a concussion panel for American sport, and so that's very relevant for today. Welcome to Aspetar.
Just to reiterate the comments, firstly, welcome to the international guests, our speakers, President Wu and the AIBA organization. As I look at the program, I'm struck by the immediate relevancy of all the topics to sport in general, as President Wu outlined. As I think of hockey and most body contact sports, you could substitute any one of them up here on the program for boxing, and it would be relevant. So, as a group here at Aspetar, it certainly is a great benefit to have the expertise from all over the world, unified by the championship in boxing, to have this great course. On behalf of the medical staff, I welcome all of you and appreciate your interest and look forward to talking to each of you as the opportunity presents itself. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And the head of Aspetar Sports Dentistry and a pioneer in sports industry international is Dr. Mohammed Al-Say. And just three quick things. He's on the actual board of the German Sports Dentistry and Dental Surgery Group in associated with the University of Tübingen in Germany, trained in Germany and international recognition there. I want to mention the emergency dental kit that he has pioneered. It's a very practical tool being used in the National Sports Medicine Program and with potential to go internationally. And also the emphasis on oral hygiene. And many people think that elite athletes have these amazing bodies and they'll have amazing teeth, but what is amazing is how bad the teeth are in many elite athletes, and they have teeth that what we think of as a 70-year-old or someone who's in an impoverished situation. And that will be brought out today. But Dr. Mohammed Al-Say has brought that public health issue to the forefront and is a pioneer on that. And in our young people and in Qatari people who need to pay more attention to oral health. So that's been a very important issue. So welcome and thank you for making this conference possible. It was his vision, together with Dr. Mohammed Gaith Al-Khwari and Dr. Popovic, to bring this to fruition. So thank you so much.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to welcome you to Qatar and to Aspetar, the leading of orthopedic and sports medicine hospital. We are proud to be the official and exclusive sports medicine partner of 2015 International Boxing Association's World Boxing Championship. And we are pleased to host this symposium on orofacial trauma in boxing. This symposium comes as a part of our effort to not only provide medical support to athletes, but to also make scientific contributions to the world of sports, including boxing. As you know, oral and maxillofacial trauma are most common in boxing. And we hope that this event allow all of us to share the information, experience, and knowledge to prevent or to reduce this type of injury. and of course to ensure effective treatment for our athletes. We are proud at Aspetar to be contributing to this, as our sports dentistry department created the Middle East first dental emergency kit that help treat any in competitions injury where oral trauma may occur, and assist in keeping athletes safe from further injury. Also, the screening process in our department has also contributed to this, as our department has been able in various occasions to diagnose different types of pathologic lesions and fractures where the patient is asymptomatic. And during this process, all athletes who considered high risk in contact sports are educated in their injury and get fitted customized mouth guard that are fabricated here at Aspetar. We hope today to share the information with all of you and learning from your global experience. And so we can collectively better understand the relationship between oral health and sports performance, and the needs for and the importance of oral protections in the prevention of sports-related injury. Again, we are honored to be hosting this symposium, and we hope that will help bring all of us a step closer to achieving the best sports dentistry treatment for our athletes, who remain our top priority. Finally, I would like to thank all of you for your attendance, and I wish you a very pleasant time today with us. Thank you very much.
Great. So we're into the guts of the program now, and we'll begin by introducing Professor Ian Needleman. And Ian is a friend and both has a professorship in oral health and surgery, and also is an important part of the IOC and their development of sports dentistry and focus on health of the athletes. So he was part of the organizing committee for the major sports injury prevention conference in Monaco in 2014. He was a member of the and lead of the international dentists who met in Lausanne to do a consensus statement on sports dentistry, and that was also published in the British Dental Journal, so International Sports Medicine Journal publication, International Dentistry publication, so very influential, and he'll share some of that with you this morning. So Ian, welcome, and thanks. It's a great privilege to have Ian in Doha.
Well, good morning, and fantastic to see a full auditorium, so many of you, and huge thanks to Aspetar for the invitation to come and to visit Aspetar and to be here and join you in this wonderful symposium this morning. So many thanks for that. I should also start just trying to anticipate your disappointment in my presentations, because you're going to be very disappointed, I'm afraid, because I'm going to talk almost nothing about trauma. So what I've been asked to talk about is oral health in sport rather than trauma. So apologies for any disappointment. And this is the overview. I'm going to talk about why are we interested in the impact of oral health on sport performance. What crazy idea is that? And I'd like to share with you some of the data that we've generated at London 2012. And a more recent systematic review to look at some aspects of oral health in boxing, and also a recent study which is soon to be published on oral health in UK professional football. So why performance? Well, talking to Dieter just a moment ago, I think there's a common thread why many of us get involved in sports medicine. And I'd like you to imagine, let's say, I think it's 6 weeks ago now. Just go back 6 weeks, what you were doing at this time. So 6 weeks ago, there was a big event in the Alps in Europe. It's one of the hardest mountain ultra trail races in Europe. It's called the UTMB Ultra Trail of Mont Blanc. And this is one of the races, the CCC, which starts off in Italy in Courmayeur. And I shall attempt to get this to work. Nope. No, I've spoiled the... how do I get the... Sorry. I'll just play around with this for a bit longer. So it starts off in Italy in Courmayeur, and 60 miles later, and about 18,000 feet of climb over six major climbs, finishes in Chamonix. Well, I think you've gathered seeing those slides a bit earlier than I expected you to see. The performance matters to me personally. So I'd prepared a lot of time. I'd spent a lot of time over the previous 6 months preparing for this race. I had a very clear race plan. I had a very clear target goal for this race. So performance personally is something which fascinates me for my own value. But also as a researcher and as a clinician, so I spend half of my week as a clinician, as a specialist in periodontics, which is diseases of the gums. I'm fascinated because patients consistently tell me stories. They consistently tell me stories about how strong an impact their oral health has on their quality of life, or their life performance, you might think of it in another way. And these stories are very strong. It's very hard not to go away without an impact. So really, bring those things together, it seemed to us that since poor oral health very clearly and consistently in the research literature affects life performance, what does it do to sport performance? And perhaps you can see why we became interested in this. So in this first presentation, I'm going to look at the scale of the problem, and then later on after coffee, I'm going to look at causes and also possible solutions to the problem. So we start off going back to London 2012, and I had the great privilege of leading a research study at the Games. And this was published in 2 years ago now in the British Journal of Sports Medicine. The aims of the study were these: to evaluate the oral health of elite athletes, but also very importantly, as with any epidemiology, to try and understand the determinants. Why did some athletes have good oral health, some not? What was affecting it? And thirdly, to look at impact on performance, at least self-reported impact. It's a cross-sectional study using validated outcome measures and clearly within a busy environment of a dental clinic in the polyclinic of the Olympic Games. You can imagine just how busy it is. The idea was to minimize impact on the dental clinic routine. So the data collection were routine demographics. We're very keen to explore health behaviors and understand what people were doing, what they were using, looking at comprehensive clinical data, the type of measurements that are routine in clinical dentistry, but also this measure of impact on performance, well-being, and quality of life. So by the day after the closing ceremony of the Olympic Games, and we had recruited 300 athletes from 86 different countries with a fairly wide representation of sports. And in terms of demographics, the continents were pretty reasonably represented, and similarly with ethnicity. So in terms of oral health findings, first of all, I'd like to share these with you. Dental caries, tooth decay. Well, common. So more than half of the athletes presented with dental caries. And I don't mean just a little bit of dental caries, I mean very obvious clinical dental caries. Dental erosion is something different. Dental erosion is not mediated by bacteria, but is mediated by acid in the mouth, either through beverages or through gastrointestinal issues or eating disorders. And it's become an increasing awareness because the epidemiology is showing in most populations, or many populations rather, the proportion of of individuals, particularly young individuals, is rising rapidly. And what we found was that about 45% of the athletes were affected with dental erosion. Gum health, periodontal health. So as you can see here, what we found was good health was rare. 3/4 of individuals had gingivitis, but perhaps more surprisingly was that 15% of them had periodontitis, which is a chronic inflammatory disease which leads to bone loss and eventually tooth loss. So remember, think about the demographics, the age of this group. Looking at the impact on performance, well, we found that about 40% of them reported to be bothered. Yeah, and nearly 30% reported that their oral health was having an impact on their quality of life. And almost 1 in 5 reported an effect of their oral health on their training and performance. And again, thinking about these athletes, and all of you in this room understand athletes more than many other roomfuls of people, you understand how important these issues are to athletes. 1 in 5 of them reported it was affecting their training and performance. And I think that's quite an extraordinary figure. Just, there are lots of data, but in the limited time today, I can only share a little bit with you. In terms of determinants, what we did find was an association between dental erosion of the anterior teeth, the front teeth, and the frequency of sports drink intake. And that's something we'll come back to later on today, I'm sure. And that dental caries, tooth decay, had a statistically significant impact on quality of life, well-being, and performance. And that's quite plausible. Dental caries perhaps mediated through pain and discomfort. So overall then, what that study has shown is that in that sample of athletes, high levels of dental disease. And we, looking at the comparison between across different populations, that level of oral health is similar to a disadvantaged population, not the common view of an elite athlete. And similarly, there is a common impact on well-being, training, and performance. Limitations of the study, it may not be a representative sample, clearly by only looking at athletes attending the polyclinic during the games. The attention this article produced was really quite surprising. This is a screenshot just from last week. And in the 2 years subsequent to its publication, it's still 25th out of nearly 3,000 articles published in the BJSM. So again, for those of us involved in oral health, it helps to give some reassurance that oral health is of interest to lots of people, not just to us dentists. And certainly the media came up with all sorts of messages in order to promote it. It's a lovely, easy story to make. London 2012 athletes had bad teeth. We want the media to promote these stories because this is a conversation that we need to have and we need to engage with many groups and individuals. Well, we then went on to look at a systematic review of oral health. And this was published at the beginning of this year in the British Journal of Sports Medicine. And we were also very excited to be asked by the journal, by the BJSM, to supply the cover image to the journal for that issue in January. And in terms of sporting careers, I have to say mine is now fulfilled because those cross-country spikes on the front cover are actually my cross-country spikes. They were in use again last weekend at the first cross-country race of the season. So for me, that's great to have those on the front cover of the BJSM. But more importantly, what did the systematic review show? Well, for those of you who are used to reading systematic reviews, I know there are a number of people in the room who conduct systematic reviews, the findings will not be perhaps too surprising. What we found were that having looked at many, many records, thousands of records, that there were 34 eligible studies. Most of those were in fact on dental trauma and not on oral health more broadly. But what we did find was that across the studies, that poor oral health was consistent finding, particularly in relation to caries, dental caries, dental erosion, and to some extent periodontal diseases. But very few data on performance. And again, like many systematic reviews, the finding was that the strength of evidence was low. There's a lot of work to do in this field. So what about in boxing in particular? Well, in the systematic review, we were only able to find very limited data, really focusing on elite sport. And most of the data is limited to dental and maxillofacial trauma. There's really very, very little indeed on oral health more broadly. And I think we're going to hear a lot more detail later on this morning, but I'm just picking a couple of more recent studies. This is one that was published from a study that took place in Iran. 120 male athletes who presented with trauma, body trauma from four combat sports, and looking at the proportion of those with sport-related dental trauma, finding that boxing, which is this column here, was equal second in terms of proportion of individuals affected with kickboxing, perhaps not surprisingly, even more affected by dental trauma. And then a large study which was published in 2010, looking at over 400 athletes, where the overall prevalence of dental trauma in these individuals was high, 50%. And boxing, as you can see, was perhaps, again, not surprisingly, one of the highest, highest prevalence for dental trauma in these participating sports. And of those individuals, 17% of them wore mouthguards, and I know we're going to hear a lot more about mouthguards later. So what can we conclude about oral health in boxing? Well, there's very little data about oral health. In terms of trying to get a sense of what the prevalence of figures for dental trauma, oral and dental trauma is, I think it's quite challenging, but it seems that the values would be certainly be over 50% of individuals. And there's certainly a question mark on the appropriate use of mouthguards within the sport. So at the moment, we're working with GB Boxing to collect comprehensive oral health data, and we hope in the next few months to be in a better position to report back with some more concrete data about oral health. And then let's take a look finally at UK professional football. So we conducted a large study during the pre-season screening period with the participation of eight UK professional clubs. It was again a cross-sectional study. Five of them were Premier League, two Championship, and one League One. And the clinical examinations were carried out by an experienced dentist. So the experienced dentist was usually the dentist associated with the club, or if not, it was an experienced dentist who carries out examinations of elite sports individuals. For inclusion in this study, the footballers needed to be senior. They needed to be 18 years and above. We limited it to senior squad to try and ensure that we had a homogeneous sample. And, of course, they had to be able to understand the consent and the questionnaire. So the sample included 189 footballers, and we had data on 187. What's important about that, it actually isn't so much the number, although it's a reasonable number of athletes. What's more important is, and critically important, is that it represents more than 90% of each senior squad. So in terms of representativeness, that's really an important finding. The median age is perhaps what you would expect in professional football, around 24, and three quarters were white, and just under 14% were black. In terms of health determinants, well, three quarters reported attending for a dental checkup within 12 months. We had no way of verifying that, but that's what they say. And 22%, nearly a quarter, reported a history of orofacial trauma, which they indicated was due to sport. As you can see, more than 60% use sports drinks at least three times a week, and that's, again, an issue that we may come back to later on. And there was some self-reporting of tobacco use, and perhaps not surprisingly, most of that was smokeless or chewing tobacco. So coming back to the oral health of these footballers, what did we find? Well, we found that this time nearly 40% had active dental caries. And what was interesting was that their experience of dental caries and restorations increased with age. So 78% of the 18 to 24-year-olds had at least one decayed or filled tooth. By the 25 to 34 age group, 92% of them were affected. Data on their own only tell a small part of the story. What I want to show you are some radiographs from some of these individuals, because I think it tells you a lot more. Talk about dental caries is very clinical, but not terribly informative. On the screen, there are some representative radiographs from one of the teams, and it shows you perhaps the real issues that we have to deal with here. We take this tooth here, a lower third molar. You can see the whole crown is affected by dental caries. I'm not sure in the lighting whether you can see. The dental caries is extended into the nerve chamber, the pulp of the tooth, and the result of that is infection, periapical infection. You can imagine just how painful that can be. You can see a similar situation immediately above and on the other radiographs there. So the message isn't just that these individuals have dental caries, but many of them have very severe forms of the disease. And to have an impact on their life quality and their performance perhaps is no great surprise. Looking at dental erosion, well, more than half had dental erosion. And again, trying to get a handle, a feel for how severe this was, nearly 40% had a moderate to severe level of dental erosion. Now looking at periodontal disease, and I'll talk a little bit more about why we might be concerned about periodontal disease later on this morning. Well, 82% had gingivitis, which is reversible, but two-thirds of them had at least half of their mouth affected. So in terms of the extent of it, it was widespread within the mouth. And 5% had moderate to severe, irreversible, chronic inflammatory periodontitis. In terms of impact on oral health and well-being, well, about nearly half, 45%, were bothered by their oral health. They didn't like it. They felt it was a problem. 20% reported that it was affecting their quality of life, and 7% felt it was having an effect on their training and performance. So trying to look at the determinants, again, I'm being selective just in the time that's available this morning. What we found was, again, dental caries with a statistically significant association with well-being, quality of life, and performance outcomes. And so it's, again, a consistent message with the London 2012 data. And it's also very plausible in terms of mechanism, which we'll come back to later on this morning. Looking at other data, which I haven't yet shared with you, where we collected athlete-reported symptoms, those that were statistically significantly associated with quality of life and impact on performances were, again, pain in the mouth, current pain related to the teeth, sensitivity, and history of wisdom teeth issues. So again, it's building quite a consistent message. So in terms of the football studies, the summary of this would be, well, it's the first representative sample from oral health research in football. And it turns out that it's one of the largest studies within professional football, certainly in the UK. The overall findings, of course, are that there's poor oral health, that caries and dental erosion are particularly prevalent, and there are clear self-reported impacts on well-being, training, and performance. So we've got a representative sample, but the limitation with this study is multiple examiners. If we're looking overall then to summarise what we know about oral health and performance in elite sport, then I think we can make these statements. That oral health of elite athletes is poor. That poor oral health impacts on self-reported measures of performance in athletes. And that certainly the evidence base for oral health in elite sport is developing. And there's a great opportunity to do a lot more research here. So our next steps in relation to this, well, we were delighted at the early part of this year to receive notification that as a collaboration with the Institute of Sport, Exercise and Health and the National Centre for Sport and Exercise Medicine in the UK, we've been accredited as an IOC Research Centre for Prevention of Injury and Protection of Athlete Health. And that's going to be very helpful in terms of future developments. Currently, we're a long way through, or we're right in the middle of a large epidemiologic study with a PhD student, Judy Gallagher, and that's a collaboration with the British Olympic Association and a number of Olympic teams, who I have to say have been wonderful in terms of the spirit of collaboration. We're also taking further the self-report and looking at the development of athlete-reported outcome measures of performance. Clearly, it's important to try and dig further down. So the mechanisms and possible future interventions are also of great interest to us. And we're looking at mechanisms of how oral health might impact on performance. And we're also looking at interventions in relation to dental erosion. Overall, as you can imagine, the future of interventions, or at least part of the future, will be behavior change. And at the moment, we're collecting data to help us design behavior change intervention. And that's also a collaboration with the UCL Center for Behavior Change, which is also a very exciting next development. As all of you know, these things don't happen by chance. And many people are involved in the team. And there are many people that we owe our thanks to, certainly at London 2012, principally the athletes who agreed to take part, but the volunteer games maker dentists and the organizations at LOCOG, at IOC, Barts and the London, who provided the dental care, and Carestream Kodak. And in football, again, the club players who volunteered and agreed to take part, and the medics, physios, and dentists that we reached out to and collaborated with. And the funding which has come from GlaxoSmithKline and a UCL Impact Award. So at that point, I'd like to say thank you very much for listening. And I hope the rest of the meeting goes very well.
Iris, you know where your slides are. So, keeping with the international theme, we're going to move to Sweden and Kuwait now. So, Lars Andersson is our next speaker, and he trained and began in Sweden, as you may guess from his name. But and in Sweden, he was at the famous Karolinska Institute, which has a strong record in sports medicine. Many of you will know people from that institute. And then he was the head of the training board in Sweden, so the dental training board for the whole of the country. So very eminent in Sweden, but then moved to Kuwait in 2002. And in 2002, he's been a professor in Kuwait. And he has he's also the editor-in-chief of the International Scientific Journal for Dental Traumatology. So this is the first of two talks from Lars Andersson. So let's welcome him to the podium.
Good morning. I'm so happy to be here. I've heard so much about Aspetar and the fantastic development we see here in Doha, Qatar. And you are progressing very, very rapidly. I'm very impressed. Thank you for the invitation to come and speak to you in such a qualified audience here. I've been asked to shortly go into the epidemiology of oral and maxillofacial injuries, and both in the society and also in a little bit what I found in the literature about boxing. I've also been asked to talk about management of fractures in the orbital region, and I'm very happy to do that. I will also come back before lunch with a second lecture where we're going to talk about soft tissue injuries. About myself, I'm originally from Sweden, and 13 years ago, I was approached and asked to come to Kuwait to be part of a great team building a new dental school from square one. And that was a challenge. I was at the end of my career in Sweden and decided to take this chance, and it's been a fantastic journey. The Gulf region is a region with a lot of interesting developments. So this is my new home. It's a little bit hotter than Sweden. And we have built this dental school, and we have graduated almost 300 undergraduate students so far. And we are now moving into the next steps with the postgraduate education. So it's wonderful to be in a place where a lot of development is taking place and where we are able to finance this also. As you can see, we have professors from all over the world in this place. Our leader, Dr. Jawad Bebehani, is here, and he's leading our team. He's a Kuwaiti. And the Kuwait is a very, very small state, so every year our 10% best students receive award from the emir directly in a ceremony. And I have greetings from our students. So today's topic is touch a little bit on epidemiology, because very, very little is written about this in boxing. But I have myself been part of doing some studies about epidemiology of oromaxillofacial injuries in the society. So I will relate to this. So we did a study many years back in Sweden where we looked at all injuries during 1 year in a county in Sweden. It was 250,000 inhabitants, and we extended this as a prospective study into 1 year, because we have seasonal variations in Sweden. And this is actually the first study that includes oral, that is dental injuries, in the same study as bodily injuries. Before that, we had seen a lot of bodily injury studies in the medical field, and we have also seen a lot of dental injury studies in the dental field. But this is, as far as we know, the first study including everything. And we found some interesting things, that the oral region is very much affected. About 5% of these injuries are affecting the oral region, although the oral region only comprises about 1% of the total body surface. And I've also painted the facial non-oral region here, because we're going to talk about that also today. But the most common in all this study of bodily injuries is hand and foot injuries always dominating. I will later come back and place the boxing injuries in here, so we can compare what happens when you box. The oral injuries can be divided into dental injuries, soft tissue injuries, and bone fractures. And 92% of people presenting with oral injuries had actually dental injuries. So dentists are involved very much with this. We also have a large proportion of soft tissue injuries, about 1/3. And of these patients seeking treatment or consultation for oral injuries, whereas bone fractures are comparatively rare. And I will later compare these figures with boxing. So where are we in boxing? I went through the literature, and very little of good quality is written. There are quite a few studies of low quality, but I found some interesting high-quality studies where with large materials. Potter reported in 2011 from the Registry of US National Electronic Injury Surveillance during the years 90 to 2008, he managed to track 165,000 individuals with boxing injuries. And he found that the boxing injuries were about 9,000 per year in US. And he found also that the injuries were increasing. And about 12 per 1,000 participants had injuries. And not surprisingly, 91% of them were men. In this study, and this is what's typical when you look into epidemiological study, materials differ very, very much from each other. He was including the punching bag related injuries. So his figures, of course, are lower for head and neck and concussion injuries than in matches. But still, and he had a high proportion of hand injuries. But still, he reported 23% of head and neck injuries. He concluded in this study that he had a national representative sample, and I must admit that it's a good quality study. It's a large material over a long period of time. And he alarmed the bell by saying that boxing injuries were increasing in numbers during this period. And he suggested increased efforts needed to prevent boxing injuries. And I'm very, very glad to hear this morning that you are looking into this. Bledsoe, in 2005, studied matches. The previous study was actually all boxing injuries, including training injuries. But these are matches, all boxing matches in Nevada, United States, 524 matches. And the rate of injury was about 17 per 100 boxer matches. And this is a figure that comes back in all these match studies, around 20 per 100 boxer matches. So it seems to be a reliable figure. Facial laceration was as high as half of these injuries. And he also saw other injuries. An Australian team looked into this in 2003. Boxing fight outcomes during competition. It was from 85 to 2001 in Australia, 427 fight participation, 107 injuries, and he also came to the same rate that 25 per 100 fight participations. This is where these studies of high quality end up. The same team also found head, neck, and face injuries of 89%. And the eye region was heavily affected. Lacerations as much as 75%. So these are high figures. The same team, but 6 years later, reported, and that was 545 boxers and 907 fights. They also came to the same conclusion, around a little bit more than 20 per 100 professional fights. Soft tissue injuries to head and face, most common. And they mentioned the figure 71% of soft tissue injuries. And it's on increasing, with increasing age, the risk increased. And that was the number related to the number of fights and the age of the boxer. They suggested that more complete data is needed, and that's what I really must agree to. We must have standardized injury definitions and to be able to compare in the same cities, in the same countries, but also between the countries, that we standardize our injury registrations. And I'm very happy to hear that you have started this work and we are on our way. Prospective cohort designs are important. And they also discussed restriction of eligibility to fight based on the age and exposure. Boxers that have a long career and have been very much exposed, we could discuss if one should look into this medically. So another study, Ross, suggested boxing history records. He discussed headgear, and I'm very happy to hear today that you have progressed in the research. This is a study from 1987. He, at that time, suggested improved gloves, improved boxing, ring floor, and many of these things have been looked into since that study was published. He also discussed avoiding blows to the head, mandatory neurological examinations, and mandatory computer tomograms, because we can actually look into the brain today, and neuropsychological evaluation, and the more competent physicians at ringside. That is what they discussed. So what has been published about dental injuries in boxing? A Polish study quite recently studied the 338 Polish boxers, and as many as 36% of them had dental trauma, in spite of the fact that 94% of them actually had worn mouth guards. So it seems as if we have to develop the mouth guards, and only 5.7 had custom-made mouth guards. And that may be something to take a grip on. And I'm happy to hear that Aspetar is working very, very hard with these issues. You have a chance to be leaders in this field, really. So let's now place the boxing injury figures by the side of injuries in the society. What happens when you do boxing? Well, soft tissue injuries, you run a higher risk and they increase. Dental injuries decrease. We said that 92% of the oral injuries were dental injuries, but that is decreasing. So probably these mouth guards have an effect here. Bone fractures increase a little bit also as compared to trauma and oral injuries in the society. We also know that we have a risk of chronic traumatic brain injuries, which has been discussed a lot. And I'm happy to hear this morning that you are taking steps and studying this. Figure in the literature is 17 to 20% of all professional boxers is motor, cognitive, and behavioral impairment that has been reported. The risk factors again come back to the same: duration of career and age of retirement. In the old days, boxers were boxing all the way up to they were 40 years of age, and the total number of bouts were enormous as compared to the comparatively short careers we see today, and I think that is good. Mortality is discussed now and then, and from 1950 and up, there were 339 mortalities. So this happens. We cannot shy away from that. But there is a decline in mortality, and the reduction in number of rounds has been important. Also, we have seen increased medical oversight and stricter safety regulation, and medical supervision should increase. That's what they suggested in this study from 2010. And again, come back to mandatory CNS imaging recommended, because this can be seen nowadays. That was the first part of my speech about a little bit touching on epidemiology. And I'm glad to hear that you are taking steps in this field. I'm now going to turn to orbital fractures. I was asked to talk about management of fractures in the orbital region. And this is a very sensitive area. Cuts in other places may just have to be sutures, but when we are dealing with the orbital region, we are dealing with a sensitive area. And the fractures related to the orbital region can either be in the internal orbital skeleton or fractures of the orbital rim or associated with other mid-face fractures. The total volume of the orbit is 30 milliliters, and the eye occupies 6.5 milliliters of this. The rest is very sensitive structures. We have the optic nerve. We have muscles that can be pinched should there be fractures. We have vessels. So when the blow is hitting the eye, lots of things can happen. And this cavity is filled by fat. And if we have fractures here, the fat is coming out, the volume of the orbit is decreased. And that will result in situations like this, one of our patients. And you can see what has happened here is that he has a frontal fracture involving the orbit. And of course, he has a vision problem, but also aesthetical problem. It changes the appearance a lot. The blowout fracture is a well-known fracture. Usually it's with smaller objects, smaller balls hitting the eye. I think the boxing gloves will stop at the outer end nowadays, but still there are some such studies reported with boxing. And the orbit entrance usually stops this with a gloves. When this happens, the floor of the orbit is fractured and the fat is falling down and the volume of the fat is decreasing, and that means enophthalmos, and that also you will have pinches of the muscles. When this muscle, inferior rectus muscle, is pinched, the patient cannot look up. Here the patient has been asked to look up, and on this side it was possible, but on the other side the eye stayed in the same position because this muscle is pinched and cannot, and the eye cannot move. And what we do nowadays with injuries like this is to expose them. We always exposure them. We go in and we have a look at the fracture pattern. And you can do that by different incisions. And the subtarsal incision is good when you can combine it with the wrinkles of the skin, so the scars cannot hardly be seen. Better is to do a transconjunctival approach on the inside of the eyelid. That leaves no scar, and you can reach the orbit or go laterally from. And what we have to do is to really reach in here to place either bone grafts or titanium nets so we can restore the volume of the orbit so it will be the same again. We use computer tomography and do this surgery on the computer before so we can restore orbits to the same size as they were. So we seldom have any problems that I showed on the last patient. Patients nowadays can be much, much better restored than 15, 20 years ago. Fractures of the orbital rim are easy to fix. It's just expose and place a plate. Nowadays, we are relying very much on plates and screw, and that was not the case if we go back 20 years. But the plate and screw fixation has enabled us to that it can bear all functional forces. It can also bridge areas of comminution. We can repair without supplemental or extraskeletal fixation. When I started as a maxillofacial surgeon, we were using suspension wires, resulting in that the maxilla was moving backwards, and we seldom could treat the orbital problems. But nowadays, each fracture should have its own individual splint. And we use the buttresses here, the nasomaxillary, zygomatically, pteromaxillary, horizontal, and the sagittal buttresses. These are thicker bone areas where we place the plate. Many of these fractures of the facial skeleton communicate with the orbit. Among them, the zygomaticomaxillary fracture, which is a very common fracture. And we simply put it back and put plates over here so we can restore this back into its original position. This was not done in the same way if we go back 20, 25 years, leaving these patients with aesthetical disturbances. The nasoorbitoatomoidal fractures was not either treated if we go back 20 years, resulting in severe aesthetical problems. Nowadays, we are very important for us to measure up the distance here and to, thanks to the plate, put everything back into position again, and that we can achieve excellent aesthetical results today and not faces like this that we often ended up with in the 70s and 80s before the plates. We measure carefully this intercantal distance because this will be very much widened if you do not take consideration into this. Frontal sinus communicates often with the orbit, and the patient I showed earlier, he had such a defect here, having impact on the orbit, on the volume, and the aesthetics. Here we use a bicoronal incision and approach from here, and you can reach far down by doing this and have access to practically all mid-face or the upper mid-face fractures. And you can, when you have raised your flap, I should say that the advantage with this is that we can treat many fractures without doing a lot of incisions. We can do it in one incision. And the scar is hidden in the hair region. And we have a delicate puzzle laying here to put the pieces back again. So this is a good approach that we use more and more often today. So this boy, he had a chance that he had not had in the 70s to get fully restored. We restored him with a plate. This is a resorbable plate that we can use. We bend it, shape it, and bend it, and put it back like this, and this plate is going to be resorbed, so it doesn't cause much problem in the long term. Sometimes in these very, very thin skin areas, patients are irritated by feeling the plates. So sometimes it happens that you must do a second entry with an incision here. But by using the resorbable plates, and they are getting better and better, we can treat such cases and leave them for resorption. So we had a chance to be restored in the modern way, the way we do it today. And this is not what the patient looked, if I go back to the beginning of my career. They usually had retrusive maxillas. They did not have the same good possibilities to restore the facial contours as we do today. That was my first lecture today. If you're interested to know more about this, I can refer to my textbook. We have written this, and you feel not only trauma here, you feel you can read the whole field of oromaxillofacial surgery. We have also a student's version for the undergraduate teaching that came out last year, where we have scaled down this to the student's level. I also recommend this book, which is a manual, step-by-step instructions, what to do in the emergency phase. I thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks very much. And moving now to Morocco and France, it's a great pleasure to introduce Dr. Abdul Hamid Kadri. And he's a sports medicine specialist. He's the head of the Medical Commission for Boxing. And so all the international sports come under the Olympic umbrella, as you know. But the Olympics don't run any of the sports, the federations run the sports. And so here we had the president of the Boxing Federation, and now we have the head of the Medical Commission. So it's a very important international position to take responsibility for athlete health across that sport for the whole world. And that's what we have with Dr. Kadri. He has 20 years experience as a as a boxing doctor. So we're going to hear from someone who very much is on top of the field as a boxing doctor. And his training was in the two countries, in Morocco and France. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Yes, I find it. So it's thank you very much.
And then this one has the trigger.
Thank you. Thank you. Dear President, dear assistants, honorable assistants, dear colleague and friends, it's a great pleasure and honor to be here in Doha to share with you some facts about boxing injuries in the term of recognition and management. As you probably know now, after the excellent presentation of my the previous lecture, sport-related facial injuries account for 8% of all facial soft tissue injuries. These injuries are most often in boxing due to direct hits, but some are due to headbutt. This is our problem now. The most common types of sport-related facial trauma are the soft tissue injuries and the fractures of the T-zone bones. It means the nose, the zygoma, and the mandible. No. Let's speak about bleedings. It means nosebleed and cuts also. So, face and dental injuries, I think that it is very important to see that The facial skin is rich in blood vessels and nerves. It is important. So lacerations and nosebleed are very frequent. You have a general profusely bleeding, but they are healing rapidly. Some locations provide severe injuries, especially if associated with fractures. I think that the different means of protecting the skin, face bleeding, the best one is good boxing techniques, heads up. But we also use something that we discovered that it is not natural. Naturally, the skin is covered by sebaceous gland, and it makes something that is oily. We experienced the Vaseline, and we can use other substances, Vaseline-like effects. So it is really something that we can really understand. So now we speak about nosebleed, just to refresh the fact that you have Kiss-Kesselbach plexus anteroethmoidal artery, and you have posteroethmoidal artery and sphenopalatine artery. That is only to point out that the posterior bleeding is more dangerous than anterior bleeding, because when you have a clotting, this clot can go in the back, and then you have a respiratory distress. This is why one of the examination of ringside doctor, the good inside doctor, must look on the throat with a lamp. And if there is blood in the throat, it is one condition to stop the bout. Facial injuries in boxing, according to nosebleed, we don't stop any nosebleed. Nosebleed is really something that is minor. If you have a moderate bleeding, you don't stop the bout. But if it is repeated bleeding, maybe you may, according to the development of the bout, you may stop the bout. But the most important circumstances to stop the bout is when you have arterial bleeding. Arterial bleeding, it means that it is red and pulsatile bleeding, and this is something you cannot stop, and you must stop the bout. Of course, as we said previously, acute compound fracture. It is important to stop it because it will be worsened. Blood running into throat, as I explained to you previously, and heavy venous bleeding. Even if it is venous but heavy, you must stop the bout. Cuts and lacerations. The most important thing to point out is that there is some problems related to the vascularization of the face. And here we have some areas that are of high risk. And you have the first one is the nose, the nose bridge. You have also nasolabial area, labial arteries, temporal area. All these are places that are of risk. And this is used to assess the severity of cuts. Classically, we had this picture showing the topography of cuts. It isn't the only criteria, but it's classically when you have a cut in the tarsal plate, you stop the bout. It is difficult, and sometimes it impairs vision. You know, there is a general principle: if a boxer cannot see, he cannot bout. He cannot box. So it is something very, very normal. You have also in the same area infraorbital nerve and tear duct. So it is something that it is a complication, and you must stop the bout. Supraorbital nerve also. But if you have a cut in external way, when there is no anatomical structure beneath, you let him box, no problem. Special problem is the vermilion border of the lip. You must stop the bout because usually it bleeds too much, and also it's difficult to take care of this sort of injuries. The bridge of the nose. So essentially, if you suspect a compound fracture nasal fracture. You must just stop it. So, AIBA has a great commitment to boxers' safety and health. And in every field, we made research to improve, a continuous improvement. So we made the research, we compiled data, and we try to find something that will be in favor of the boxers. So in this scoring scale, I did a summary. You know, we collected 5 years, of boxing, fights of boxing on WSB competition, World Series of boxing, and we computerized all this according to the injury, the decision taken. I treated it by SPSS in the Faculty of Medicine of Rabat, Department of Preventive Medicine, and we found out this model that will be implemented. So we have three parameters. The first one is the length of the cut, and we stratified the cuts in three categories. So it is coated 1, 2, 3. You know, 1 centimeter, 1 to 3 centimeter, and 3 centimeter. The second one parameter is the bleeding. It's related to the depth of the cut. And here also we had some criteria to assess the bleeding, if it is responsive to simple pressure or not. And then you have also another dimension. It means Cartman intervention. I'll speak to you about Cartman further. And the last one is associated, you know, it is associated location, dangerous location. As we say it previously, if this location is absent, it is zero. But if its location is present, you double the score. So it gives you something like this, with a total score of 12. And for example, if you have L2, it means that it is between 1 and 3 centimeter, and you have bleeding, coated 1, it means that it is easy to stop, and etc. So, and the score is 3. So you let him box. In the opposite way, if you have same 2, yes, and here 1, but it is here, you have associated condition, then you call the cutman to cure the cut. If he stops the bleed in 45 seconds, you let him box. But if you have a location, a dangerous location, every time you stop the bout. So we have a scale, and over 6, maybe over the 6, you stop the bout. And here you have to take a decision. It is just a way to help in making the decision. About scalp cuts, they are not dangerous. They are bleeding too much, but they are not dangerous. Otherwise, if it is deep, and to assess the depth of this cut, you have this minimal technique. So if it comes to subcutaneous tissue, you can consider that it is deep. So some illustration, as presented by the previous lecturer, I must point out that the fact that all these data are not related to amateur boxing. Zazin and McCrory studied professional boxers. So it is the same thing. I have many difficulties to find out many of these injuries because we didn't have it in amateur boxing. So I picked them from professional boxing. And this is from professional boxing, for instance. So blue dinos with acute fracture, you see the deviation. Of course, we stopped the bout. Compound fracture before and after. So you have also this supraorbital nerve injury. It is in professional boxing. So you see here that you see the structure inside. The nerve is appears. So it must be stopped. And when it is reflected, it's like this. So it's the same thing. You see the the nerve inside. And after this, you have eyelid. They are very difficult cuts because eyelid is very sensible to the suture. It must be done in specialized area by ophthalmologist. We must not try to do something in the venue. We refer always this boxer to the hospital. Lacrimal duct in injury, as you know, the problem is that this is the consequence of a cut that was not taken at time. So it makes this. And Catman and bleeding mitigation, yes. Let's speak about Catman. I spoke to you about Catman. It is something that was implemented in MMA, in professional boxing. His duty is to stop the bleeding during 1 minute in the break. So there are persons that are not trained in a university hospital or anything. There are people who have only basic, like paramedics, basic skills, but they are very efficient in stopping the bleeding. Otherwise, the bout cannot continue. So this person, for instance, they use adrenaline, they use some Vaseline mixed with some things, So they have the special way to stop the bleeding, and it works. So for this purpose, you have hemostatic drugs and endswell also, because you use chemicals, but you use also cold, physical means. Endswell, they put it in ice, and it diminishes the swelling. So AIBA Catman in AOB, we introduced it, and we make the Catman a natural Catman, and the Catman has 45 seconds to stop the bleed. In our opinion, we recommended that we change it maybe to have more time to treat the cuts. It will be more efficient. If we put the Catman in every corner, in each corner, and give him 3 minutes instead of 45 seconds, it will be better. So oral injuries, oral injuries. You see here a cut in the vermilion border. So we stop the bout, yes. But it is only the only injury. When you see in the radiography, you see that there is something that is not usual. And in fact, when you come and see it, you remove a piece of teeth, a tooth, which was broken inside. This is something that is related to the fact that there is a protective effect of the gum shield. And if the boxer isn't biting very firmly the gum shield, he can have broken teeth, he can, he can have many problems. So it is something that we can speak about in prevention, the part of my lecture. So averse or broken tooth, here I must point out the leading role of Aspetar implementing this dental emergency kit. It's really something that will be of a great use in all sports, especially in boxing. And I think that it's something that we must mention here. And you have, sometimes we used classical methods. We put the tooth in milk or something, or put it under the tongue. But with this kit, I think it will be better. Eye injuries, yes, swollen eye. It is, spectacular. But if you suspect a rupture, you must stop the bout. It is your appreciation. Every time when you are at ringside, you are an official, but you are first a doctor. So you must behave as a doctor, and our concern is safety of the boxer. Black eyes. Yes, black eyes. So, normally if you have black eyes that doesn't impair vision with no one of these symptoms, you don't stop the bout. But in some cases, you have to stop the bout if you have double vision, diplopia, or loss of sight. He said, I don't see anything, so maybe retinal detachment or something, we must stop the bout and send him to the medical room for assessment. If there is a fluid leaking from eyeball, so it's important, inability to move the eye, it is one of the symptoms of a blowout fracture, so it is an entrapment, and blood or clear fluid from the nose or the ears. It is something that is very dangerous. Blood in the surface of inside the eyeball and some associated signs of medial wall orbital fractures, so as a crepitus, as in ophthalmos, as entrapment, reduced mobility of the eyes, and persistent headache that can be sometimes very common, but it is one of the main symptoms. So here we have a explanation of the blowout fracture, yes? Blowout fracture, the diagnosis. And here it is important to show you here. You see that here it is broken, and the fatty substance goes inside. So this is something that is demonstrative of one case. So it lost its air density, and the fat from the orbit herniates into in, as it said in the comment. Eye injury, you have different sorts of eye injuries, from corneal abrasion to retinal irritation. And the most important thing to remember is, as a doctor or simply as a coach, you can notice that the boxer has flights or flashes or multiple spot floaters, then you suspect retinal irritation and you send him to the ophthalmologist, because it is the early stages, you must take him before that it worsens. So mandibular injuries, we are more close to oral and orofacial trauma. Personally, in 20 years of boxing, I saw only one case. It was in 2005 in the Francophonie Games in Niger, Niamey. And it was a boxer from Cameroon who lost his gum shield. He bought a new one, but it doesn't fit. He was always opening his mouth. When he received the blow, she had a problem. He stopped. He said, he raised his hand. The bout was stopped. They called me. When I opened the mouth, it was open. I look inside. I see too much blood. The first reflex is to ask him, please open your mouth so I can retire the gum shield. He cannot open his mouth. So it is one of the 2 points of the diagnosis: profuse bleeding and inability to open the mouth. So normally you have pain or motion, tenderness, but it is important, unable to open or close the mouth. So it is important. And there is a swelling, mandibular asymmetry. Sometimes you see that there is an asymmetry, discoloration, hematoma formation. You know, you have a crepitation sometimes, but it is too painful. Sometimes you avoid to do this. And if you have two or three symptoms, it is enough to send him to the hospital for further assessment. There is also salivation, because irritation in one place produces salivation, and of course, bleeding is profuse. It bleeds too much. You cannot see anything in the mouth. Findings, so you know, physically, when you examine the boxer, you find that he is not able to put the teeth. It is a malocclusion. So mobility, bimanual movements and pain. And here we must do it carefully, because it is extremely painful. So you have hematoma, gingival tear, etc., and deviation of the mandible. All these are from the doctor when he examined the boxer. So here we see mandible fracture. So it is before and after, you know. And you know, you have here, it's indicated here. So it is very, very clear to do. But fortunately, In AIBA, we have some protective measures that reduces too much the injuries. We introduce rules. For example, when a boxer is in a difficult position, the referee has an 8 count. He counts 1, 2, 3, to 8, and this makes a little bit rest for the boxer, and it avoids many of the injuries. So this is one of the reasons that we have not such injuries in AIBA boxing, because it is not no more amateur. It is AOB, Olympic style boxing, or open boxing, and we have a WSB, World Series of Boxing, which is semi professional, etc. And we have APB, AIBA Pro Boxing also. So, X-ray fracture of the mandible, you see here. And you have also the treatments. I pass the treatment because there are many schools in the treatments. So the TMJ dislocation, Barton Lane Bridge, etc. So the TMJ dislocation, you can reduce it. If it is possible to reduce it, normally the boxer can continue to box. But sometimes you are not sure that you did a good reduction because you have no X-ray, etc. So maybe it will be more wise to stop the bout and to send him to a further assessment. Other injuries, it is only historical injuries, because now in AIBA we don't see no more saddle nose or cauliflower. You know, it is only for history. It was before, but now we don't see these injuries. It is consequences, boxers, and cauliflower injuries. Yes, we don't see it. We have no injuries. I took it from MMA or professional boxing. Eye injuries. Eye injuries are very important because we can prevent eye injuries. The most important condition is retinal detachment. And retinal detachment has two causes. It is intraocular surgery and high myopia, more than 3.5 dioptries. So a high level of myopia can be an important risk factor and of spontaneous retinal detachment. And I think it's very important to disqualify this type of boxer. The second thing, you see that 3.5 dioptries, actually in USA, many ophthalmologists said that minus 3.5 dioptries is something that is excessive. And there are research that they can change it. They propose to have 6 dioptries, but in luck, since there is a lack of evidence till now, we are on 3.5 dioptries. You know, more scientific evidence. So, cut prevention program. You know that AIBA has a great concern about preventing injuries. And the first prevention program was focused on cuts. So the cuts result in many factors. And you have sharps, but you have not sharps. Gloves scratch. And this is why we do a tape around the gloves to prevent the scratching of the gloves and roundness of the gloves. This is one of the duties of the referee. In the beginning, he inspects the gloves. So it is something that we do every time. So boxing material and gloves control are a very good state. The second one is block power, the strength of the power. Rotational impacts are more painful. They provide injuries more than direct blow. Direct blow with the padding, it doesn't produce too much in injuries. Otherwise, if it is very, 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 very strong. And also, if you have bone structures beneath, when you have these T-bone zones, they are more likely to have cuts in this area. So you must teach the boxer to protect this zone. He can use his hands, etc., to protect his face. So there is also a factor related to skin thickness. Human person we are different. Some has a good thick of the skin, and some has very thin skin. So if you have a thin skin, you are more likely to have cuts than the other person. It is something that is biological variability. And you know also that the quality of the skin, dry skin with no elasticity, leads to cuts. And this is why in the prevention edge medical means, we used a non-sting barrier film here. And this non-sting barrier film acts in two parts. The first one, he increases hydration because a layer, it stops evaporation and increases hydration. And the second one, it increases elasticity. So it decreases by 56% the occurrence of cuts. And when the cuts occur, they are linear. They are not, you know, so it is cuts that are easy to suture or to take. This is what, and also, in summary, we have heads up. Heads up with general prevention means, rules enforcement, refereeing, boxing techniques, etc., are 80% efficiency than medical and prevention means. We have only 20%, but the most important thing is this program. Cut prevention program, we have our objective is to decrease cut rate by 50% and to have this every 1 year, every 2 years, so we can mitigate a lot of cuts. The means are coach training to improve boxing techniques, and it is the program of heads up, clinching techniques, open rushing control, use hands, how to enter the clinch, how to go out, etc. Referees positioning, the referee must be in a position that he can control the boxer. And ringside physicians, you know, cut prevention evaluation alternatives. So we use this artificial skin, etc. So the most important message I must not miss is the importance of gum shield in oral and facial injuries prevention. The importance of gum shield is really great because, and it is fairly documented as a preventive tool against broken tooth and TMJ dislocation or fracture. A gum shield must be personal. It must be adapted to the boxer and controlled by a dentist because it is important. And now we can have custom-made, you have some machine to have really proper gum shield that protects. And I think that's this is why in AIBA rules, when the boxer throw down the gum shield repetitively, he is sanctioned. So we, by this way, we protect more the boxer. Face and dental injuries. In conclusion, because I finished, I'm sorry, I take time. So I think that's the most important message I would like to you to remain is that broken or avulsed teeth, they are the best way is to have the Aspetar dental emergency kit. I think that it will be really something positive for boxing. The second point is about cuts. Cuts, I think that's the doctor's decision is crucial, and it depends on facial cuts topography, and we must also depends on cutman role. If you have a good cutman, you can go till the end of the bout. If you have a bad cutman, you will be obliged to stop the bout. It depends on the quality of the cutman also, because we work as a team. Stitches cannot, you know, if a boxer has classical stitches, he cannot box. But if you do subcuticular stitches, I mean sub-barrier stitches or subcutaneous stitches, you can box. The boxer can box. You can use Steri-Strip. You can use topical glue, etc. And I think that the nosebleed is usually not severe, but you must always look for associated injuries. And the prevention of jaw fracture and dislocation are better done with a good cam shield. So I think that I finished. And I would like to thank the organizer of this symposium to allow me to share with you these things. And also, I wish you a good success of this symposium. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much to all the speakers for keeping us on time. Now we have a 15-minute break, and we'll be back here at 10:25. And join me in thanking all the speakers and our VIP guests, including President Wu.